all of this is done, after we absorb materials from the colon and we're down at the end of the tract, the last thing that has to happen is defecation. So the process where the undigested materials are removed from the body. And the rectum down here, the rectum is the site where feces are stored. In order to remove material from the rectum, what has to happen is this whole tube has to contract longitudinally. So we have muscles that do that, muscles that will shorten this tube. And as a consequence of that, if the sphincter is open on the end, then the feces will leave the body. So it's due to these muscle contractions. There are abdominal muscles and pelvic muscles that can help with this as well, in addition to just the muscles that are in the walls of the rectum. We're going to end this section with a couple of problems that can result. So what is diarrhea? Diarrhea is probably the most common problem that's tied to the colon and what's going on in the colon. Diarrhea is feces that have an unusually high water content, so they're really watery. They're not as hard as they normally would be. This is something that can have many different causes. Diarrhea can be caused by viruses and by bacteria. There are some bacteria that release toxins, and those toxins cause more water to be released into the lumen of the colon. So it just draws water out of our cells more. But then there are other bacteria that actually make their way into the mucosa. They make it into where our cells are at. And then that can trigger inflammation and immune response and produce what would be called inflammatory diarrhea. So there are different mechanisms in place that can end up causing diarrhea. The end result is not pleasant in any case. The biggest concern with diarrhea is dehydration, just the fact that we're losing more water from the body. So it's important, if you do have diarrhea, it is important to up your intake of water in order to help compensate for that. Diarrhea is something that it's not uncommon to have occasionally for short durations, like for a day or two, maybe you'll have diarrhea and then it goes away. But if it lasts long term, if it lasts for weeks, that is not normal. That's something that's unusual, and that can be an indication of a problem, some sort of underlying condition. So this leads us to, I mentioned this before, inflammatory bowel disease. The key symptom of this is diarrhea that persists. It doesn't just clear up and go away. Sometimes it will even have blood in it due to the inflammation that's going on. Abdominal pain, it's very uncomfortable, fatigue even, and weight loss that's not intended. All of those symptoms put together could indicate that somebody has an inflammatory bowel disease. This is something that can have a number of different contributing factors. We still today, we don't know the exact cause. However, genetic studies suggest that there are some genes that predispose people to developing inflammatory bowel disease. If a person has those genes, then this condition can be aggravated by diet and stress. So diet and stress do play a role as well, even if they're not directly the cause. They might aggravate the problem. And what do both of these do? These can play into that microbiome, right? We know that diet affects microbiome. So there are many different contributing factors that might lead to development of inflammatory bowel disease. As far as pathology goes, the end result is that there's decreased mucus production, which leads to other changes. There are also changes in the tight junctions. Fewer tight junctions means there's more permeability, and that's not a good thing. That can lead to erosions of the mucosal lining of the intestines and consequently inflammation. So this is something that once it develops, it's hard to get it back under control because there are so many things at play. Inflammatory bowel disease is not uncommon. It's been on the rise for a while in the US. It's kind of speculation at this point. It's thought that maybe this is due to the diet of the United States. We don't have a very good diet in general. I can't speak for individuals. Maybe you have a great diet, which is fantastic. But in general, Americans don't have a great diet. We tend to, again, have low fiber, high fat, high sugar. And we want it to be just the opposite of that. We should be having high fiber, low fat, and low sugar in order to facilitate the health of the GI tract.